It's just a pleasure to welcome back the founder and publisher of online resource, WolfStreet.com. Welcome back, Wolf Richter.
Thanks for having me back, Chris.
Perusing some of your must-read articles on Wolf Street, you're concerned, as are many folks, about this echo bubble in the housing sector. And I'd like your thoughts on your latest article, one of them, in the past few days. The most splendid housing bubble in America, first year-over-year drop. Tell us more, please.
So we've had, since 2012, essentially, year after year after year of house price increases in the major metro areas in the United States. Now, there are some exceptions, Detroit and Cleveland, and, you know, some cities. Not every housing market participates in this, but among the biggest ones, they essentially did. And so this time around, so we're talking about the Case-Shiller data here, and which compares home sales of the same house over time. So it's different than median prices and average prices. It's slower moving. It indicates things later than other metrics, and it's not as volatile. So what you see here is a little bit behind the curve, but it tends to be smooth and a little bit more accurate than some of the ups and downs we see elsewhere. And so what we have now seen is that we, in New York City, or in the New York Metro and in the San Francisco Bay Area, that condo prices have declined for the first time on a year-over-year basis in this metric. Now, we have seen that before in median prices, but now it's showing up in the Case-Shiller. And, you know, the Bay Area is probably one of the most overpriced markets in the country, and the New York metro, particularly Manhattan and some of the other boroughs, are in the same basket. These are indications that we're bumping into a ceiling here. And, you know, salaries are really high in the San Francisco Bay Area for people who participate in the tech bubble here, and for people who are in finance, you know, they're not really high for other employees, but they're fairly high for these for the tech industry. And so there's always this thing that it's not a bubble because people can't afford them. You know, people can't afford to pay $1.5 million for a starter shack or for a two bedroom condo somewhere, and that is running out of steam. There's a ceiling we're bumping into now, and we've seen this, you know, and this ceiling hasn't, you know, the NASDAQ hasn't crashed. That's usually an indication that things go to heck in the Bay Area is when the NASDAQ crashes, but that really hasn't happened yet. So what we're seeing is just a natural limit. The market is running out of people who are willing and able to pay $1.5 million for a two-bedroom condo, you know, or $1 million for a one-bedroom condo. If you make that kind of money, you want to live in something nice and big. And in the Bay Area, you can't get that anymore. So, that's a big indication. In other markets, that really hasn't happened yet. Seattle now is flat year over year. So Seattle house prices are flat. Seattle went through a gigantic house price surge over the last couple of 3 years or 4 years. And so that has run out of steam. In some of the other markets, the increases are much smaller. We're looking at 1 or 2%, 3% increases on a year-over-year basis. In the most expensive markets, we're now running into some kind of natural ceiling unrelated to the stock market and unrelated to employment. Companies are surging for people in the Bay Area. It's hard to hire people here. You have to pay a lot of money. So this is not an economic downturn that's causing this. It's just bumping into a price ceiling. Yeah, they've risen prices so much that it just doesn't move forward anymore. And so now, obviously, you know, we're waiting for a turnaround in the economy. That I don't really see that happening right now. The economy here is really strong. It's strong in Seattle. You know, it's strong in New York. So it's not an indication of the economy turning south here, but it is an indication of an overpriced market that's hit a ceiling.
What they do so well at Wolf Street is illustrate the magnitude of the regional aspect of the Case-Shiller Home Price Index. I'd like to add these into a slideshow, so be sure and check out the video that accompanies. Some of these areas, they haven't eclipsed even their previous Great Recession bubble, you know, 2006 to 2007 peaks. Much of Tampa, much of the South, Washington, maybe you could comment or speak to what you see happening here on the East.
Yeah, so picked up Miami. So let's throw in Las Vegas and Phoenix also. And they're kind of in the same basket. So these were housing markets that went completely bonkers during housing bubble one. So I call it housing bubble one because it's the first one in this century. And now we're in housing bubble two, so the second one in the century. There have been prior housing bubbles, but I'm just counting in the century. And for example, in Miami, home prices between 2000 and 2007 almost quadrupled. So when you think about that, you know, you bought a $100,000 condo in 2000, and in 2007 it was, or in 2006, yeah, it was worth $400,000. So it's, when you look at the chart, and you'll see that in the video that you're putting together there, Chris, and after that, at about the same rate, prices collapsed, and they collapsed all the way down to 2002 level. So they gave up almost all the gains. So that $100,000 condo you bought in 2000 became $400,000, and then returned to about $115,000. So, you know, people borrowed money on these high valuations and then walked from their properties. And the banks ended up with it. And so this was a huge, gigantic housing bubble. It was completely nuts. There's no other word to describe this. So it collapsed, as it should have. And so now it's going back up, you know, but it's going up at a slower rate. It's still a very steep rate. And in Miami, we're just 13% below the peak of the crazy bubble of that ended in 2006. And so when you look at the chart, you see that it has surged at an incredible rate. Now, prices have essentially more than doubled in the 6 years, but it is not quite as steep of a rate as it was before, and it's not quite back yet to the same level of where it had been, but it's already way overpriced. So, I mean, this is the thing about these housing bubbles. Yeah, they haven't quite gotten back to the level where they were in Miami, in Las Vegas, in Tampa, and in Phoenix, but those housing bubbles that they had in 2006 were just so outrageous to go try to go back there, and that's where they're headed. You know, so right now they're still a little bit off, but and obviously, you know, we've had time passing between 2006, so people are making more money. There's been some inflation, so getting back to the same level doesn't mean it's just, but it's just slightly lower than we had in 2006. Now, you just can't compare these three cities with any other market in the United States. Just those were the epicenters of the housing bubble and the epicenters of the housing bust. So now they're just trying to struggle to get back up there. And when you look at the charts, and please embed them, and when you look at the charts, it's just a head-scratcher. This whole thing just visually makes you think, do this? And, yeah, they're getting there again. So we're on the way.
I would like you to speak to, if you don't mind, your Denver house price or the Case-Shiller Home Price Index chart. I mean, we're looking at a chart here that virtually experienced no parabolic growth during the early 2000s and has gone vertical, according to your analysis. How is this an anomaly, and how does it maybe tie in against the backdrop of housing bubble or North American housing bubble?
Yeah, Denver is one of the cities that skipped housing bubble one. Yeah, and Dallas is another one of those. There were several where home prices rose, but they didn't skyrocket. And in Denver, over the 6 years between 2000 and 2006, home prices increased roughly 40%. Now, there's still a pretty good chunk of increases, you know. It's not like they didn't have any kind of price surge, but compared to what they've had since. And so prices dropped for a few years after 2006, but didn't collapse. And then, what they've had since then is just incredible. That every year, year after year, they've had phenomenal price surges, and the dynamics have changed in Denver. You know, Denver has become a really hot place to be, and I mean, when you go to Denver, you realize, you know, at the edge of the Rocky Mountains, not like they're out of space. You know, the one end of the of Denver is going into the plains, and the next biggest city going east is maybe Tulsa, Oklahoma. You know, so there's lots of space there to go. And of course, going west, you're heading into the Rockies, and so there's some limits there. But it's a beautiful spot. You know, the climate is great. It's close to skiing. It's got a lot of stuff going for itself. But it's not like they're out of space to build. In some cities, you can say that. In San Francisco, you can say, well, it's surrounded on three sides by water, and you can't build anymore. Even though that's not accurate either, because there are many areas in San Francisco that need to be redeveloped, such as the Hunter Point Shipyard, Naval Shipyard area that's now essentially being redeveloped. But in Denver, you know, you have all this space. So why does a market surge to this extent? And that remains a mystery. You know, it's just what a housing bubble looks like. It's irrational. It doesn't make sense. People make lots of money doing this, and it goes on until it doesn't, and then it stops, and, you know, things turn around.
Keeping with your housing bubble theme there, is there a chance that this is still primarily a regional bubble, that it hasn't yet become systemic, and therefore we might see other areas participate, like Denver, like Seattle, before we see another 2008-2009-style meltdown?
Yeah, and that's an excellent question, because normally we don't get national housing bubbles and national house price crashes. We get them locally, and then you don't notice them nationally because they kind of average out. So on a national basis, we don't normally get all housing markets go up together and then all of them crash together like they did in 2000, in the early 2000s. Yeah, I've lived through the housing bubble and housing bust in Tulsa, Oklahoma during the oil boom and oil bust. And in Texas, too, you know, they were local, and home prices there were completely disconnected from home prices in other parts of the country. And elsewhere, you didn't even notice the drama that was going on in Oklahoma and Texas. Lots of banks failing because of real estate borrowers defaulting on the loans. You know, I mean, it was a complete fiasco locally. But nationally, it didn't even hardly make any ripples. So that's the normal condition. Normally, we have local markets that go into a bubble and that then collapse, and there's local ramifications, and they don't make a lot of difference on a national basis. What we had in 2006, 2007 was a kind of a national bubble that and then kind of collapsed together. And it differs. I mean, some housing markets back then turned around in 2005, others in 2006. San Francisco didn't turn around until late 2007. I mean, throughout 2007, we thought San Francisco, the thing was, San Francisco's different. Home prices will never fall in San Francisco. You know, they can't. And as all heck was breaking loose nationally, home prices were still rising in San Francisco. And then November 2007 hit, and suddenly it was over and prices crashed. So that was an unusual situation to see so many housing markets over a fairly short period in time turn south together. And right now, this is not quite the case. We have some of the biggest ones that I picture in this particular article. Yeah, but then today I'm going to publish the counter article to this, as the housing bubbles that the former housing bubbles or non-housing bubbles, you know, that haven't made it, and that includes Detroit and Cleveland and others, where there was no housing bubble one and there is no housing bubble two, and things are pretty depressed in the real estate market, even though Detroit's now coming up a little bit. So there, and at this point, I don't see a real threat nationally like we did last time. The real threat, I think, is locally. And that's a good thing, you know, because this stuff is funded by national institutions. And so if a local housing market blows up on them, it's not such a big deal. And the Fed might not step in. I mean, if it's just San Francisco, Bay Area and a couple of other markets that turn south, but nationally, you know, it's kind of flat. I don't think there will be a big reaction from the Fed or from anybody else, really. I mean, that's just a risk of doing business, you know, and that's kind of what I'm looking at. I don't see a national bubble. I see a number of local bubbles, and I see a number of markets where the housing market is really in bad shape right now.
I'm so glad to hear you say this, because it makes me less concerned, quite as bubbly as some folks are indicating. And I love the Dallas area too, Fort Worth. Move on to U.S. equities. We've had pundits and others just wrong the entire way. The roads are lined with the carcasses of the bears.
That's a good way of putting it. Yeah, you know, the equities are, you know, overpriced. That doesn't mean that they will crash. Now, they've come down very hard last year, and to the point where the Fed panicked, and then the Fed unleashed a torrent of verbiage that the markets interpreted as being a U-turn, even though the Fed hasn't done anything, hasn't cut rates yet, and it's still doing its quantitative tightening, even though it's slowing it down. So the markets have recovered from the sell-off last year around the all-time highs again, meaning back where they were in October last year. And, you know, this is something that will just continue to baffle people. But there's a large amount of money that supports this. And and part of this large amount of money is from corporations buying back their own shares. And I just put some data up to date on this, you know, with Apple in the first quarter buying back $23 billion worth of its own shares. $208 billion in total for all S&P 500 companies in the first quarter. You know, we had a record $800 billion in share buybacks over the last 12 months. I mean, this is a lot of money flowing into the stock market. And what happens when a company buys back its own shares? It depletes, it uses its cash, and some of them may borrow money to do that. So the cash goes to the sellers. The company gets the shares get canceled, so the company ends up with nothing, and shareholder equity actually on the balance sheet drops by that amount. And so it's a hollowing out of the company, in essence, and yet it provides an enormous support for the stock market. And when in the fourth quarter last year, when stock markets really hit the skids and went down, maniacally, corporations bought back a record amount of shares, which slowed down the sell-off and probably stopped it. So it's getting very big now. The numbers are huge, but this has been the same principle over the past since the crash, essentially. And now we've changed the tax law so companies can quote-unquote, repatriate the profits they have socked away at their overseas mailbox entities, and they can use that money now on the preferential tax treatments to buy back their own shares, and they're doing it in just huge numbers. So this gives support to the stock market, and it inflates it's financial engineering, yeah, but it inflates stock prices in a number of ways. And I mean, you can be a bear about the fundamentals, and you should be. I mean, the fundamentals are terrible, and it's overpriced. It's overvalued. But as long as these companies can continue to spend hundreds of billions of dollars a year buying back their own shares, yeah, there is support for the market. Now, this is not it's not going to last forever, because this money that the quote-unquote repatriating is limited, you know, and they're drawing it down. So that support from that direction will not last forever. Also, when credit cycles turn, borrowing gets a lot more difficult, and then companies can no longer borrow to buy back their own shares. And so that will dry up. So this is a very cyclical activity. If you look back at it, you know, there's peaks, huge peaks and big troughs. And the troughs happen during crashes when companies suddenly cannot buy back their own shares anymore. And then the support falls out from under the market. So this is something that that's really important to watch. As long as companies can buy back close to $1 trillion worth of their own shares every year, that gets a huge amount of support to the market. And as long as there are specialty funds set up, and that's a large amount of money too, that jump in every time there's a sell-off. And private equity firms are into this, hedge funds are into this, they're raising funds for these kinds of sell-offs now. You'll have buyers. You'll have big institutional buyers jumping in. But I don't think that we're going to see the stock market skyrocket, because it's really kind of in trouble. But we also won't see a huge crash, because there's all the support lining up underneath it. And it's been very tough if you try to invest based on fundamentals. The fundamentals is really a money losing game, or has been a money losing game over the last 10 years. It's been a momentum game, a game and a story game, but now it's being supported by buybacks, and when there's a crash occurring or a sharp sell off, it's supported by funds that jump into this. So it's tough to be excited about this market.
I think you really smacked the cover off the hardball, because every money manager, every portfolio manager, every institution, and every investor out there, they're taught from day one, right in B school, you've got to have that portfolio of shares and bonds. And so that sweet mutual fund money continues to flow. And as you point out in your article again today, what if this runs out of juice, the biggest share buybacks, when you give five companies with $55 billion in buybacks? Folks, we're going to include these share buybacks in, so you can, again, be sure and get that slideshow off YouTube. Fun few weeks here in the precious metal sector. That's our bread and butter. Any positive thoughts maybe on the XAU shares or the metals in general?
I mean, gold's been doing really well, obviously. But I have a concern. My last year, my strategy for gold was as a hedge against a stock price and a bond sell-off. And that works, so when you have stocks and bonds selling off and gold doesn't go anywhere or goes up a little bit as it did last year, then your hedge works. Now, all of this stuff has been going up together. So my theory about gold as being a hedge against the sell-off in stocks and bonds is sort of being undercut right now. And I would like to see when stocks surge like this and bonds surge like this and treasury surge like this and everything goes up, I would like to see gold go down. So that my theory is confirmed, that when everything else goes, the gold will be stable or go up. And so now my theory is being shot to pieces. And so I'm a little bit concerned about that. But it certainly has been fun in the gold sector.
It's always a good ballast. I know you're a sailor from time to time. And, it really does kind of keep an even keel in the portfolio. It's that, maybe the proverbial free lunch we never really get, but we hear so much about. Wolf Richter, a lot to digest today. Do your portfolio a favor and bookmark, of course, GoldSeek and WolfStreet.com. Wolf Richter, please return.
Thank you, Chris.
Shopping for fine jewelry just got easier. GoldSeek.com has identified the most successful jewelry brand to launch in recent times. Many Jewelry is rewriting the way consumers buy fine jewelry. Integrity Craftsmanship, the only company to sell 24-karat gold and platinum jewelry, avoiding confusing alloys and gems, a true precious metals investment. Many Jewelry's disruptive business model embraces Franco-American craftsmanship and direct-to-consumer economics, rapidly disrupting the $20 billion monopoly, just like Amazon and Uber. The sky is the limit with $1 billion of jewelry purchases daily for loved ones and those special occasions. Many Jewelry is an innovator positioned to capture market share, with annual sales growth in the industry topping $30 billion by 2021. Many Jewelry coined the term investment jewelry, pricing by the gram, transparently disclosing its profit margins, a truer investment in pure gold or platinum. Similar to real estate, even artwork, Many Jewelry has a weighted value, easily calculated, ensuring value wealth as a long-term investment. With sales in 60 countries around the globe, 20,000 orders already, don't miss out on the explosive growth potential. Many Jewelry trades under the symbols MENE on the Toronto Exchange, and in the US, MENEF. Remember to sign up to Many's share Shareholder Club to receive shareholder news, updates, and special discount codes for jewelry purchases. Remember, many jewelry. GoldSeek employees may or may not own shares. Nothing contained herein should be construed as investment advice. The blockchain revolution is transforming the global arena, disrupting every industry in its path. GoldSeek.com is excited to introduce an off-the-chain opportunity in digital gold and silver from our friends at Atmex and Sprott.com. One Gold holds physical gold and silver metals at the Royal Canadian Mint, the first online marketplace to offer secure and convenient buying, selling, and redemption of digital precious metals. One Gold uses Vault Chain, a secure, immutable blockchain ledger developed by Tradewind Markets, the leading innovator in digital precious metals distributed ledger and blockchain technology. Vault Chain. Gold and silver are 100% redeemable through One Gold for physical precious metals delivered to customers' doors in any size at competitive prices and low transaction storage costs. As a special offer and for a limited time only, One Gold is offering gold and silver at spot price with no additional premiums. OneGold.com is secure and accessible 24/7 on any device, offering convenient purchases and sales of precious metals. Easy recurring transactions make passive saving and gold dollar cost averaging as easy as a single mouse click. Vault Chain offers the best tier pricing on AppMex products, setting the industry standard as a fully backed physical asset with easy redemption in coins, rounds, or bars, offering clients peace of mind and full transparency. Don't get left behind. Remember to bookmark OneGold.com for the safest and most convenient digital precious metals today. Remember, OneGold. GoldSeek employees may or may not own shares. Nothing contained herein should be construed as investment advice.